I mean, we've been documenting the state of Karnataka with photography and filming over the last several years, and we thought we have no film to depict our own state, Karnataka, which can talk about all the aspects of the state, starting from mountains to the dry lands to the coral reefs, the rainforest. So we said we should first make a film about our own backyard, and that's how the concept of Wild Karnataka came into being. Thankfully for us, the Karnataka Forest Department is very supportive. They're very helpful. They're one of the savviest and one of the most approachable government departments that I've ever worked with. And when we went with the idea of making a film for the state, they were more than happy to help us and support us in terms of permissions and access and everything else. So I think it's a fantastic collaboration between the private sort of cameraman like me and the 15 people who worked on this film, along with the government.
Yeah, as you said, what were the key challenges for Wild Karnataka? I think the key challenge for Wild Karnataka was the sequences which you visualized to happen when there was a crew shooting it. For example, we wanted to have where the hunt happens is usually in a lantana. So those sequences did not happen. But one of the very important sequences which we wanted to showcase was the great Indian bustard occupying the landscape which occupies and feeding on a painted grasshopper and a calotropis. We literally waited for years for that sequence to happen, and the bird is just a handful of them. They did materialize, but they never did the behavior which we expected them to do. And probably it was our bad luck, or probably when we were there, it never happened. It so happened that we waited for weeks. The bustards didn't show up. And the day we were driving back, we get the message the bustards were located. So I think it's just a fate of thing that the sequences did not happen. That is the first challenge.
We were there in Daroji, which is in Ballari district. And it was in the peak of summer, 40 degrees, 43 degrees centigrade. It was really hot. And we were there to film bears. But it rained on one day, and then after that, there was actually no bear activity at all. So we wanted to film bears, but the bears were not coming out, and it's peak summer. We actually would fill a 2-liter bottle and freeze it in the forest department fridge, and then take it onto field, because then we would just sip with whatever water would melt, and it was that hot. And then we thought, okay, these bears are not coming out at all. But then we started seeing activity of peacocks, because that's pretty much the time that the peacock lekking happens, and it was like these peacocks were all over the place. So the peacocks would come out and start establishing their territory. They would just size up each other. Two males would size up each other, and then the fights began. So we hadn't really planned for a peacock lekking sequence, but we were fortunate to be able to see it in the wild, and that was something really special. And it's special also because Sir David Attenborough, in fact, he made a special mention of this peacock lekking sequence from the film Wild Karnataka. He said that he hasn't seen a peacock sequence like this in the wild ever in his lifetime, and that's really, really special.
So yeah, I mean, there were quite a few moments where we were disheartened because the rains did not happen for a year or two, so we couldn't photograph or film the waterfalls. We did not get the elephant congregation. So between both of these things, which are very iconic for our state and very, very iconic and very important for the film to have these, we were definitely disheartened. But the following year, the rains picked up and it went very well. So I think it was just a little bit of patience that was needed.
My most memorable moment was, of course, the peacock sequence, because Sir David made a special mention of it, and we got to see something so beautiful out in the wild. And what other thing is very special for me is the Draco sequence, because filming Dracos was also quite challenging. You can never predict where the flying lizard, the gliding lizard goes and lands. So that was another challenge, and filming that was also special. And especially because having grown up reading Purnachandra Tejaswi's books, and one of them is Karvalo, where he mentions about the Draco, filming that for Wild Karnataka was very memorable. And I'll have to mention that I enjoyed all the mandaki mirchis in Ballari and the conversations in the rain-soaked Agumbe, where we would sit for hours at Agumbe Rainforest Research Station just discussing anything and everything, including Karvalo.
So for us, from day zero, we wanted to show the unseen side of Karnataka. Of course, Tamil Nadu, we've all traveled quite a bit, and you know, it's close to our hearts. But then again, that is a Karnataka that most people who travel do know. And we've always wanted to focus on lesser-known species and lesser-known behavior, because I think that is what people have to get aware about. And this was a conscious decision from day zero. And in fact, I still think we have a lot more of Kabini than we would have ideally liked.
Let me tell you very frankly that we are totally overwhelmed with the response we got. I mean, like, to tell you very frankly, it's been months. The movie, the documentary has premiered and it's yet to sink in, and every day we still get people responding saying that, wow, we never believed that we could get some to see something from Karnataka, from India, a film of this caliber and on almost on best with the world. That was something, the response across every place has been overwhelming. Every time we had a little screening and there were people saying that, okay, the show is full, we would like to wait for another hour. Once the movie is over, we would like to go and watch it again. Or probably there's a new set of people who actually stood for an hour or more than an hour just to see when, so that we'll have a next screening. So that has been the kind of response, and that was really, really heartening for this thing. And in this day where you're actually bombarded with so much content on your phone, people taking time out, actually walking into places of screening and sitting for more than full hour and watching this Wild Karnataka was something very, very heartening.
About getting served here, it was a lot of hard work. We obviously had to have a good product, because he would not lend his voice to anything which is substandard. Harry Marshall, who's one of our friends and who heads Icon Films, we went to him and said, you know, we really want Sir David to voice it, and he said, I will try and ask him. And
Sir David having to utter a few words which were not familiar, like saying Karnataka itself. I think the first time I heard, the whole my body had goosebumps. And the best part was when we did a small sequence where we actually wished people in Kannada itself. I think that was the high point of the whole experience. I think that has been really great for us. So having David Attenborough come on board is something, is a testimony to the quality of the film we have put across. I think having a world-class figure saying that this is a film I want to be a part of.
We did tell him that, you know, India is 1.3 billion people, and this is the first time Indians have put something like this out. And, you know, we would really like you to voice over. And I think it was a collaboration and a lot of goodwill, and of course the film being of a quality that he could lend his name to, which made this all possible.
This is Wild Karnataka.